Hi, I'm Rob.
Hi, I'm Sherry.
And this is our cat, Lily. This is Cinder. We've got the truck.
We've got the trailer.
And we're ready for our RV travel quest.
Hi, I'm Rob.
I'm Sherry.
And this is Chapter 6 of the RV Travel Quest Mission Series. Today's title is Final RV Preparation for Fulltime Travel. So this video has been made exactly 5 months from Chapter 5. So what we'd like to talk about is what we've done between that time to get ready for full-time travel, which is about a week away. Mm-hmm. So one of the first things we wanted to talk about was moving into the RV and what we had to do to train our pets. So in September, we literally moved into our RV in the general area that where we work. So we haven't quit our jobs or anything. And so during that time, it's given us a chance to see what living in an RV would be like, and it would give us a chance to work in our processes so RV travel would be a little easier. So one of the other things we had to do was get our pets trained to live in the RV and get used to the routine that they had when we lived in an apartment. So what did we do?
So with our dog Cinder, she had been trained when we lived in our apartment to, she was no problem staying at home when we were at work. However, because we only used our RV on the weekends, more of a vacation type home, she wasn't used to being alone. And so if we ever tried to leave, she would have a tendency to bark. So we had to retrain her to stay alone in the RV. And we did that by, we started by using her kennel and just leaving her in the kennel. And that only took about a week. And she was, then we started leaving the kennel door open, and we didn't have any trouble at all. So it wasn't long and before we took the kennel down, and she's set to go. Had absolutely no trouble with the cat.
No. One of the things we had trouble with Cinder is when we were using our RV for the weekends, I think she kind of looked at the RV as playtime, and it was kind of no pattern to anything. So we were concerned that moving into the RV, she'd be in that mode. But she surprised us in only a short period of time. We had her changed over to living in here and being perfectly happy, waiting for us to come home from work. So that was nice. The next thing we had to do was start getting our truck ready. So we decided to make sure that while we were well employed and we both had good paychecks, that we that we made sure that everything was working well. So really, Cinder. And I do want to remind you before I go any farther is we want to keep our pets and animals in the video because this is real. This is real RV living. This is real life. And so it is a show, but at the same time, it's real life. And we want to let you know the things we go through, especially with this dog. So with the truck, we had to make sure we addressed all the brakes and all the tires are okay. We did have a recall on one of our front tires, and it was kind of nice because they're very expensive front tires, because on a diesel, front tires wear really fast. So a year later, there was a recall on those tires, and they literally replaced those tires. And so we've got some really good tires in the front, and got them replaced, and so now they're only a year old, and so that worked out really good. We also had to replace or repair our turbo. It was leaking, and so we had that rebuilt. Recently, we just changed the truck over to synthetic oil, and that was a little expensive to do. I think the Dumar truck was about $220 to do that. So Synthetic oil is not cheap, but it's recommended for good performance on the engine. So the next thing I want to talk about is memberships. Mm-hmm. So what did we do?
So we kept most of our memberships that we had, which was the Good Sam. And then we expanded and took on Thousand Trails. They have a zone pass, of which we were able to get in on one of their specials, which was two zones for the price of one. Mm-hmm. And those zones basically cover the full West Coast states. What else?
And down to Arizona.
Yeah, area. Through Arizona. Mm-hmm.
And we wanted to do that because our ultimate goal is to keep our overhead down. So the Thousand Trails, after doing a lot of research and talking to people, has convinced us that it will save us money considerably as we travel down the coast. And our interest is mostly in the Northwest, so we think it's going to pay itself off very quickly. So we also used to have Passport America, but we went ahead and let that lapse because we found this before, when we did full-time travel before, is it had so many limitations.
Yeah, it had a lot of restrictions that, you know, it was only good on weekdays, or it was only good for you know, one day, and it never seemed to coordinate with the days when we needed to use them.
Yeah, that's for sure. So we'll do in the future more videos on how the memberships and discounts work, but since we haven't actually hit the road for until a week from now, I want to get that under our belt first before we do any videos about it. So we'll let you know how the Thousand Trails worked out. The next thing I'd like to talk about was the big thing we had to do was we had to take our small car down to Arizona. And so, explain a little bit, we have a Mazda 3. And it's a good car, very little miles, it's brand new, we bought it new. But we don't want to get rid of it. So what we decided to do was, during Christmas, we would drive it down to Arizona, give us the opportunity to see our kids and have Christmas with them, and leave the car with them, which kind of helps them out a little bit, and it helps us out because we didn't have to put it in storage. So that was a big trip. We took 10 days to do that, so we literally took 4 days to get down there. It was supposed to be a 1,500 mile trip.
Ended up being 17.
Yeah. So we got down to like Oregon and hit snow, and so instead of dealing with the snow, we decided to divert over to the coast and then come down the coast a ways till we got away from the mountains, and then came back inland, so it added more mileage to the trip. So we had to do 1,700 miles in 4 days, and then we spent time with our family, left the car down there, and then we flew back, and we just got back last week. And so we are literally only about 6 days away from full-time travel. So the other thing, I actually didn't write it down, and I actually just thought of it, is during this time, the last time you saw us, we were in an apartment. Since then, we moved into the RV in September. It's now December, well, January. So we've been in the RV for 4 months, and which is, our plan was to, one is we had the opportunity to get out of our apartment, and the lease was up in September, so it made sense to go ahead and move into the RV. So we're still in the local area, and we still were holding our normal jobs. We just moved into the RV, which has turned out to be a great, I highly recommend it, because it has given us a chance to get organized, how to plan, how to get chores done, how to store things, get used to putting things away when you're done with using things, which I'm the worst, and I'm still working on it. I'm still working on it. I'm a man in work. So also during the last 5 months, we're going to skip that subject.
we made some bigger purchases. And the reason we did that is because we're fully employed. So we both had very comfortable jobs. I'm fortunate. I retired at 55, and I just did that a few days ago. We'll still have to do things to make extra income. But...
You're retired.
I'm retired. So we bought over... We decided to try to pick up all the big ticket items ahead of time.
As much as we possibly could.
Yeah, and some we've actually had some last minute things happen here. But one of the some of the first things is we invested in some other cameras. Mm-hmm. We got the new Brino, which is a time-lapse camera, and we also bought extra lenses for that. We wanted something that was a little more flexible than a GoPro time lapse. So we're looking forward to using that camera. We also just picked up a 360 degree camera, which is a fascinating camera, and we're still kind of trying to figure out how to utilize it and make it do what we want to do. It's hard to edit that type of film. So camera wise, I think that was it. And we also bought some new lights. We're using some of those lights today. Mm-hmm. What are camera equipment? Do we get anything for your cameras?
No, we did not get any. I didn't get any new cameras, but we.
Sorry.
But we did take my Canon, and we took it in and had a good cleaning
good
done.
Cleaning. Yeah, that's right. Yep. And so the next thing that we purchased that was a bigger ticket item was a Wilson Wii Booster, which is for cell phones. Our trip to Arizona kind of gave us an opportunity to see how well our phones worked. And we had chances to see when they didn't work, and it was kind of frustrating. A Wii Booster, we got a simple model that can be used in the car and in the RV. Mm-hmm. And we will do videos in the future to let you know how well it's working. But we definitely know that we needed to invest in boosting our cell phone signal so we could do our mapping and do our travels.
Yeah. We'll have to still see how that works. There still are definitely spots that are very weak, and we'll see if it really works for us or not.
Yeah, I think actually when we leave here next week, we're going to an area that's going to test it right off the bat.
Yep.
So... be looking for those videos. We're going to some special places. The next thing we just discovered is there hasn't been a lot of sunshine here lately, but the sun came out a couple of days ago, and you get the you know how you get the sunbeams through the windows, which is not happening today. It gave us a kind of chance to see how much dust particles were in the air.
Just
we're kind
floating
of
in
floating
the air.
In the air. We're going, oh Lord! So we just invested in a new AirMaster. Air filter? Well, what's the proper name for that?
It's an air purifier. So it's helping to filter the air and take out the dust particles and allergens in the air.
Yeah, especially since we have pets, too. That...
The pets were in such a small area and stuff. You know, we don't have allergies. We're very fortunate in that.
Yeah.
But we'd like to keep it that way, too.
That's true. You know, the older you get, the more it seems like you get more sensitive to things. And mm-hmm. I think that's important that we try to, because we're so confined, I think having something to help collect the dust. And if we start getting down south, we're going to deal with dust, just dust from the desert area. But like I said, we have pets and dandruff. And
there's plenty of dust up here, too.
That's true. The next thing we also bought was a gimbal for our GoPro. Maybe it's age, but you know, as we're taking the GoPro, we use a mono stick, I guess they call it, and I can tell I'm not as steady as I used to be. So we're looking forward to doing a lot more photography while we're walking and things like that with the gimbal that will kind of steady our shots a little bit. So those are not cheap. Those are in the 200 range. So that's another item we picked up for. Because we do so much photography, and obviously we have RV Travel Quest to do all our presentations, we really wanted to have good camera equipment.
Mm-hmm.
And we've also invested a little bit in sound. We bought a little bit, got one more wireless mic.
Right.
We also just launched 6 months ago RV Talk Radio, so we also have some podcast equipment that we're trying to tweak in. So a large investment in the podcasting has been done, yet we haven't used the equipment yet because I'm trying to figure out how to put mixer boards in someplace in this RV that is out of the way but has to be accessible. So, and I'm trying to find out how to make it mobile.
That's still a challenge right now.
Yeah, so we're sticking with the regular mic system I have for the podcast right now, but we do have very good equipment and better microphones for that. That was not a cheap endeavor either. We also bought some, you know, we've been buying tools.
Tools for both the truck and the RV, just common household tools and just things that trying to predict or anticipate what could we possibly need while we're out on the road.
Yeah, and we also just got a compressor.
And the compressor we found was really great. We have our bicycles that we hopefully intend to be using a lot more. And it sure was great having those to pump the tires up.
Yeah, we bought a Vi-Air compressor. And I got to tell you, I've never really used one before, but I know they had the little cheap plastic ones. This thing was dynamite. So having a good compressor, I think, is going to be critical to make sure that our tires are set at the right settings. And for our bicycles and trying to do a hand pump, we're just getting too old for that stuff. Well, not her, but maybe me. But anyway, so that's the kind of thing. Constantly finding things, extra sealants, extra tape, extra cutting tools. Another big investment we did, well, it wasn't expensive, but we got temperature measuring tools for?
So for our oven and for the refrigerator freezer. So where that came about was if you're trying to cook in your oven, one of the things I noticed right off the bat was you don't get an even heat. And I never could get the temperature right. You know, I set it at 350, which is what the directions call for, and cook it for the amount of time, and it's nowhere even close to be done. So it was real easy to figure out that I wasn't getting even temperature, or the temperature wasn't getting to where I wanted it to be. So we did actually made two purchases for that. One for the to create the even temperature, we got a pizza stone, and I purchased a industrial pizza stone. It's a 12 by 12. It fits in the oven just wonderful. It's 1 inch thick, which is really heavy. It's very, very heavy, and it does have a tendency to take a lot longer for the heat to get up to temperature, but it does serve its purpose of keeping the temperature even.
I also figured it'd make a good weapon.
Yeah.
Thing's heavy. Oh my goodness.
It is very heavy. Yeah. The other thing we got was a, I just went and got a real simple temperature gauge that I'm just leaving the oven so I can monitor the temperature. And we also got one for the refrigerator freezer as well.
We also got a handheld.
That was our second purchase, and there was a story behind that one.
Yeah, and there's a video about that, but we had trouble with our refrigerator, and so as we were troubleshooting that refrigerator, we ended up having to measure it a lot and kept opening the doors and everything. So we got the handheld laser pointer type of temperature monitor, which those things are awesome. And the other thing those are good for is while you're traveling, if you're worried about your hubs on your trailer or your truck, you can take that temperature and just hit each rim and see if the temperatures are consistent. If you have one particular tire that's warmer than all the others, it's probably likely you're having problems with your bearings. So it's a good tool for all types of things. But in here, it was really good to monitor our appliances, just make sure they're working right. So we also ended up buying another refrigerator.
Yeah, because our refrigerator that's installed here actually just kind of stopped working. It wasn't holding temperature or anything, and we were troubleshooting and everything, and we finally got to the point where we had made an appointment to take it in, have it looked at, but we needed something to put our food in, so we went and purchased just a small, I don't know, what is it, 2.5 cubic feet?
Yeah, just a little guy.
A small thing, that enough for us to put at least a little bit of food and beverages and stuff in, and found it fit really nice in the back, in our rear entertainment section. Just fit right under the little countertop there, and it works great.
Yeah, so we're actually, the refrigerator is working fine, but we're actually glad to have the backup refrigerator.
Right.
So when we do any bulk shopping and we don't have enough room in a regular refrigerator, we now have a backup refrigerator for either extra vegetables or anything like that, or just extra drinks and water, anything we want. It can only run when we have electricity, but most likely that's when we'll be buying a lot of things, because we're staying at one place for a long period of time, and the backup refrigerator would be nice to have.
Right. So.
Moving on to a different subject, is we also set up a post office box. A lot of people asked about that.
It's not really a P.O. box. We actually went to, it's more a mail forwarding
service.
Yeah. Because we wanted to, we didn't want to go to just the postal service and get a P.O. box. So we went to like a mailbox plus one of those type locations. And that offers mail forwarding services, but it also allows for packages to be delivered. Whereas a U.S. postal box at the post office, you can't have packages delivered. At least not that I'm aware of.
There's exceptions to that, but the route we went was most common sense.
Right, so basically we set it up where they will hold our mail, and then when we get to a place where we're going to be for a few days, we just call them up and say, can you please package our mail up and ship it to wherever our location is.
Yep.
And the place we're at, they just ask that we put a little bit of money into an account, they hold on to it, and then when we the money's depleted or gone down, we just
give them more money.
Give them a little more money, and we're set to go.
During the time of the 5 months between the last video and living in the RV, the other thing we had a chance to is to tweak our furniture.
Yeah.
So one of the main things we did is we had a little dining room table with four chairs.
Mm-hmm.
And we also used that for computers and things like that. So we found that there was no reason why we had to have all four chairs.
No, it's just the two of us. So we actually took two of the chairs out, and in place of the chairs, we put two folding tables
for our laptops.
And so, and they're kind of set up against the wall and stuff, and so we just kind of turn away from the table to the little,
little tables, yeah.
And we now have two workstations set up that we can both have our computer set up at all times.
Yeah, and we did do a video showing people what we did. So I'll try to put links to all these different items to the other the older videos we did. The other thing was we replaced the two chair recliners that were in the RV and replaced it with a big cushy one that was in our apartment, and it fit, so we're pretty happy with it.
It was a lot more comfortable, so we only put one we took two out, put one back in. It is much bigger and stuff, but I have a tendency to sit on the couch here a lot more, and Rob uses a recliner, and it just gives us a lot more space. And then by taking that recliner out, we just put a little shelf kind of above in the corner where I can put some plants, and it's a three-tiered shelf, so we can put a few things to for storage.
Yeah, we showed that in our video prior to this too. So yeah. So furniture-wise, I think we also took out another chair with a little refrigerator that we put in.
Yeah.
Had a chair there too, and we got rid of that too. And we didn't get rid of them; we put them in storage in our storage unit with all of our personal belongings we have already.
All right.
Up there. So someday we probably will settle down again, and we didn't want to rebuy televisions and furniture and stuff, so we put everything in storage. We took it to pretty far away from here to a smaller town, because the cost was at least 40% better than in a big city like Seattle.
It was substantially less expensive to go further out.
Definitely. So, yeah, so our stuff's far away, about 60 miles from here. The next thing we had is, it was kind of funny, we had the power go out the other day, which most people go, oh, what an inconvenience, but for us, we got excited.
We got to test things.
Yeah, we got a chance to test the new solar that we put in, and the battery backup, and the inverter system we put in the back, to see, because we're not going to be big-time boondockers. When we do, we just want to be 1 day to 3 days at the most. So we changed our batteries out, and we did a video on this too, to 2 6-volt batteries, brand new. And we put an inverter in the back with a switch up front that we can convert to 110 for our entertainment system in the back to be able to watch movies or watch our television when we're under 12-volt power. And we just put an 80-watt solar panel up on the roof that'll help trickle charge our batteries when it's light out. And we also have a generator, so we can really fire up charging up our systems quickly. So it just didn't make sense to put a lot of solar panels in, but it would be nice to have that trickle charge. And the other thing is we found is when we stored our RV for a long period of time, our batteries would be dead. Mm-hmm. This is designed to constantly keep my batteries up. So even if there's something small load on them, my batteries will always be 100%, even if this was sitting in a storage area for 2 months. So we're really happy to have that. So so with that in mind, we also changed out a lot of our lights.
Oh, yeah.
So we changed a large percentage of our lights to LEDs.
Mm-hmm.
Turned out that that's an expensive endeavor.
Yes, it is.
And so we probably spent a good $550 in LED lights. And we have a lot more lights in here. And so what we decided to do is like, okay, if we're boondocking, what lights would we use all the time?
Mm-hmm.
So we picked out the lights that we knew we would run most of the time, and we make sure that those are the ones we used when we're boondocking and not be inconvenienced. So we actually have a whole living room area here that we're sitting in that has regular lights.
Right.
And our whole kitchen area is all LED. We did our
bathroom
and a hallway light area. All are LED. And so we know that if we're boondocking, that those are the lights that we are going to be using. And we can't use the other ones because they draw too much amperage. So.
Now when we did this not as a all endeavor. It was done over a several month period of time, just to spread the cost out. You know, we would pick one light and just do little purchases at a time to spread the cost out a little bit.
Yeah, so not cheap. And we didn't have to change any fixtures. We were able to change all the bulbs with LED insertion. So it worked out great. So the next thing we wanted to talk about was when we traveled down to Arizona with our car, we had a chance to try a couple of our apps on our cell phones. The three main ones we were using was TruckPath, AllStays, which is cost $10 to put on your phone, and Google Maps. And how did you feel about those?
So out of the main three, I used the Google, just plain Google, the most.
Yeah.
But we weren't pulling a rig at that time either.
Yeah.
So I do think that would make a big difference. For when I was using it, I used the truck path looking for rest stops and truck stops, gas stations, hotels, because we did stop and stay at a few hotels. And I did use the all stays for like Walmarts and just short quick stops. Not that we stayed there, I was just kind of checking it out. However, once we had to go find some chains for my car to get across one of the mountains, and that's when I was using the Walmart. So they all worked good. Each one had a little bit of a uniqueness to it. I think we will use the AllStays quite a bit more once we're actually pulling a rig.
Yeah, we did add a Magellan navigation system to the truck. And, of course, we didn't have that when we were taking the car down. So we did buy the one that comes out of Camping World that has the built-in Good Sam campground directory. So we're kind of anxious to see how well that's going to work in real time. But
right.
That's definitely going to be our primary tool. But it's nice to have those apps on your cell phone.
I actually tend to use more than one at a time.
Yeah, I don't trust it.
So the Magellan is great. I really like how it shows what lane to be in when you're running the freeways and stuff like that. But we have found that sometimes you can just get in situations where it's either not registering properly or there's been construction. And so then I'll use the Google Maps, navigation system there, to help with some of the traffic. And so I actually have a tendency to use more than one at a time.
Yeah. And they don't always agree with each other.
No, they don't. So. Most of the time they do, but on those occasions when they don't, it's really nice to, or if you have a glitch where it freezes up or something like that, you know, I typically have already kind of planned ahead what our route was going to be, so I'm really not having any big surprises.
Yeah. Another subject I want, Sherry brought up, is we wanted to kind of mention to you some of the paperwork that you should have on board when you're traveling. And some of it might sound ridiculous, but we, you know, since I retired, we had to turn in paperwork to do that. And what was the two things we needed?
So in order for him to complete his retirement, we needed to prove that we were married.
Yeah, so we had our marriage license.
So we needed our marriage license. But you also want to make sure that you bring your birth certificates, your pet's medical records, your own medical records, any tax information if you're going to be traveling, so that you're prepared to do your tax returns if you're on the road.
Passports.
So any paperwork, it is important that you make sure that you create yourself a box or something that so you have that available. Otherwise, it could be extremely difficult, you know, if you go to the doctors and they're asking for history or something like that and you don't have it.
So medical records is, we're fortunate we don't have anything dire, and so we don't really have much in medical records. We have more for the dog and cat than we do for us. So, but if you have conditions, that you better bring that kind of paperwork with you so you can present to a hospital or a doctor if need be. So the next thing I want to talk about was, while we've been in the RV for the 4 months, I guess one of the things I don't have written down here is this has been a good opportunity to find out whether you're going to kill each other. Not everybody can live together in close conditions like this, so it's been a good opportunity to find out what works and when each other needs space, what's comfortable at night, what's comfortable in the bedroom as far as where you put things, where to put alarm clocks, where to how to deal with the pets. It just goes on and on. So the 4 months we had living in this RV has been very productive and very helpful to allow us to know. I think it's going to make our travels easier.
Right.
Yeah, because we have a chance to kind of work out our processes. So.
Now, some of the areas where we haven't been able to test out yet is the fact that we did have jobs, so we weren't here 24 hours a day.
Yeah.
But even so, one of the things that I know, we have a tendency to step outside more frequently because we do live in a smaller space. So that gives us the opportunity to just go for short little walks more often, taking the dog out, go socializing a lot more with people in our local surroundings.
And not necessarily together sometimes. Sometimes you need go for a bike ride for a mile or so, take Cinder, and gives her a chance to get a break from me. And I tend to like to go out and yak with people, so I'm always out there. And so it doesn't have to be 24/7 all the time. If you need more space, respect that with each other. Mm-hmm. And because of an RV, you tend to, you know, you are going outside more. That's your space. Even if some people just need to go to a library or do something or do some computer time at a Starbucks instead of in here, there's several ways to get that break from one another. And there's nothing wrong with that at all. That's healthy. Been married for 35 years, so those are realities. And so, but not everybody could do that. So one of the other things I wanted to bring up is because of being in here in the last 4 months, we've gone from summer to winter. So it's given us an opportunity to work with how we're going to heat this thing. So the reason I want to bring that up is we have to kind of modify how we used our electric heaters. And for a while, we were really using the gas a lot, and I was getting a tank of gas every week. And that had to change because that's an average of $20 to $22 a tank. And so, you know, that's $80 a month, easy. So what were some of the things you've discovered with heating?
We found that it's much easier to keep the temperature kind of at a steady pace than let it, every time we leave, to turn everything off.
Yeah.
And then trying to reheat it, especially when you get into the extreme colds and you get into freezing temperatures. So I have a tendency to, at nighttime, I turn everything down to right around 63, 64 degrees. And I normally keep one electric heater on down in the living room area. And I tend to like to sleep with blankets in when it's a little cooler, so we don't have anything in the bedroom at all.
Yeah. But it's, I think it's just been good to kind of, it kind of tells us, we had a chance to kind of find out what heaters work the best, which ones are best at night. There's been a lot of trial and error, how to set the gas. Another benefit to living in your RV before you travel is that's a big issue of understanding how to deal with your heating.
Just closing your blinds and stuff on those cold days, even though it may be sunny outside, I'll close the blinds just to keep the heat in. Or just the opposite, on those really hot days, I close the blinds to keep the coolness in as well.
No, silly little thing, but it's really helped out, is when we're in hot weather in this thing, Shuri actually put tinfoil in the skylight that's over the shower, because it was actually producing a lot of heat.
A lot.
And so we've actually left it there, and it really made a difference when we put that piece of tinfoil in that skylight.
It made a big difference during the summer.
It created a lot of heat. Another thing that we had a chance to learn how to do, and we're still learning, is being in an RV with the 4 months that we've had, is dealing with the cleaning. And we already talked about that we were discovering that lint and dust was an issue, and we put a purifier in. Another one has been moisture.
Moisture. Because of the cold temperatures outside and the warm temperatures in here, we get a lot of condensation on the windows. And so I will periodically actually go in and wipe all my window sills down, because you actually start to get a little bit of a mold. And so I really pay close attention to that.
Yeah. Carpets. A lot of people go to the wood floors. I like carpets, especially when in the morning you come out and you're bare feet or just socks. I don't like a cold floor. But a lot of people do like the wood floors because they're easy to maintain. So definitely we have to, put a lot more, another thing we've added, a lot of throw rugs.
Yeah, just some in the hallway carpet runners and some just throw rugs in the kitchen areas, just to help out a little bit.
Yeah.
It works great.
Yeah, and vacuuming is actually really easy in this rig. We have a built-in vacuum and a hose. It's a two-person job. I hold the hose so it doesn't flop all over, or vice versa. And it's really easy, actually, to vacuum this place up.
Yeah.
So, the other thing with cleaning is our pets. So obviously, if you have a cat, we have a litter box, and Sherry's I'll clean a litter box, but she really maintains it the best, so I have. But if you're going to have that in RVs, you
have to maintain it.
You maintain it a lot, so she's really good at upkeeping the litter box. I'm pretty sure if anybody ever came in an RV, they wouldn't know that we had a litter box right behind a chair. She maintains it that well. And when you have a pet, too, you're going to have pet fur all over. So when you vacuum, it's more than just doing your floors. It's doing your furniture and even the eaves. You never know where fur will get. So it's a battle, but that's something we had a chance to learn how to maintain the RV with those kind of conditions. We talked about how we're dealing with the airflow. Another thing was dishes, how to deal with doing dishes. We don't have a dishwasher anymore. So luckily, she likes to wash dishes but hates to dry. I hate to wash dishes, so I love to dry. So it's worked out really good. So we're not at battle at that at all. And and I don't mind if I have to wash the dishes once in a while. It's not that bad. But our routine works really good with doing dishes. And we do them constantly. And try not to let it build up in the sink. Clothing.
Laundry. I hate doing laundry. But it's one of those necessary evils. And so pretty much once a week I get my quarters and go to a laundromat where we're currently at. Most places we've ever stayed, there has been a laundromat on the facilities. And the biggest challenge there is not enough machines for the number of people in the premises.
And give yourself time.
So, you know, a lot of times it's go down, oh, can't do it, or you have to, you're there a lot longer because you can only use one machine at a time or something like that, so it takes a little longer. So you've got to really plan accordingly or plan to go off premises to find a laundromat in a town and stuff.
Yeah.
It's not difficult to do, you just got to plan for it.
And one thing that people say, well, why don't you get a washing machine in your RV? And we actually, in our RV we had prior to this, we had a washing machine combination.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, it worked, but
I didn't like it.
She didn't like it because, why?
It was a combo unit, so it did the washing and then did the drying. And our clothes would always come out wrinkled.
Really wrinkled.
And I just didn't like that.
Yeah, over the top. So we know it's been a long video, and we just wanted to kind of tell you what we've been doing in the last 5 months. It's a very exciting time. We're literally only a week away.
1 week.
From actually hitting the road. And so a lot has gone on to get ready for this time. We felt that this was the time to get our next chapter done, which was what we've done in the 5 months. The next video, we're going to talk about our goals and plans. And I think we'll probably wait a week for that when we're actually on the road, because it could help model that a little bit. So in a few weeks after this, I think we'll have chapter 7, which will be the final chapter for the mission series. So we urge you to feel free to play this video over and see if you captured something that we've talked about. Please leave comments below for any questions that you may have. The follow-up on what we've talked about. It's hard for us to go in complete detail without having a real long video. We do ask you guys if you would please share our videos. The mission series is a very important series for people preparing to be RVers.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of people just say, go do it. And I think older folks, I guess, we tend to want to, what's the plan? And so this is a 2-year plan that worked for us. Some people may need 5 years. And everybody's condition or situations are different. So this, you may need 3 or 4 years, or maybe you can do it in a year. Or maybe you're already retired and you can do it even faster. But all the things that we've talked about in the whole series will be helpful to making sure that transition goes well. So I just want to say, if you get the chance to share our videos, please do. Please leave your comments below. Please like our videos. And please make sure you let people know that this exists, and let them know what this is, a realistic view on getting started in RV and full-time living. So I'm Rob.
And I'm Sherry, and hopefully we'll see you on the road.
Yep. Bye now.
Bye.